to the first Tennessee First Chat. I'm sitting here with Coach Zach Azzanni, and this is the first time we've done something like this. So let me talk you, the fans, through it. This is all for you guys. I want you to send in your questions at the bottom of your screen, and we'll pick and choose them and answer them. And we're just going to hang out here for the next half an hour.
Sounds good.
All right. Let's just start off with what I want to know is last time I talked to you was on signing day. What have you been doing since? Please tell me you have some vacation time.
Vacation. No, no vacation time. We had a couple days just directly after signing day, but from really just a couple days, and from then we hit the off season running. We have we're working with our guys twice a week on the field with skill development. Can't have footballs right now, so working with our guys right now. We get a little bit of film time with that, some meeting time, but not much. And the rest is recruiting, and also looking at our quality control from the season ago. What can we do better on offense, defense, special teams?
And what have you seen so far out of these new guys on campus? Are you comfortable with them? You liking them? Are they working hard for you?
They fit in great. Good. Yeah, they fit in great. You know, it's neat to have them out there. You forget, like, all of a sudden a month ago those guys were, you know, going to fifth hour, and now they're with us. But they've been great. Our older guys have done a great job. The expectations now that Coach Jones has set forth, now our older guys know what to expect. People forget, like Josh Malone, until January, every day was new for the last year. You feel like he's been here forever, but he hasn't. So our older guys, including the guys that were in here last semester at this time, have really been helping our young guys out, and it's been a smooth transition. They're all doing well.
I mean, you've played college football, so you know what it's like to have a lot of pressure on you at a young age. So do you have to sometimes remind yourself, hey, these kids are 18, 19, 20 years old?
You do. You do. You have to remind them. I mean, when they leave this building, the media, Twitter, people are very supportive, but they're also that small percentage that can be pretty critical. And we forget these kids are 18 to 22 years old, and they're making mistakes, and we're helping them through it. And, you know, we've really I've done a good job in my position this year of getting back to the basics of coaching the young man. If I can coach the man, the player will come. So just all the decision-making processes on the field. We have a guest speaker today coming in to talk to our guys about, you know, domestic violence, sexual awareness, like all different things that we do every Wednesday. You know, we'll have talking about, you know, anything from substance abuse to just all sorts of things. Then tonight we have career night, which we have a bunch of businesses from town that come in. Some of our former players are now working in the business world. And our kids dress up suit and tie, and they go to these guys. And
super fancy.
And, yeah, and it's a whole networking thing. So we do that called Real Life Wednesdays every Wednesday to try and get these kids to become better men, not just football players, because they are young still.
Okay, so you told me about who's going to come tonight. But what are some of the guys that you've had come visit in the past and talk on these Real Life Wednesdays?
Well, that's a great question. We've had everyone from Maurice Claret. Ohio State running back, everyone knows his story and kind of how he kind of fell from stardom and just letting him kind of tell his story. We've had, we've had a ton of people. We've had speakers come and talk on the I generation. So how these kids get all their information on social media and, you know, what you have to guard against. And it was good for us coaches on how to connect to these players a little bit more, because our generation is a little bit different. We're all caught up, but they had never had anything before this. This is their way of communication. So how we can be better coaches and players together with social media. And then tonight, like I said, domestic violence type things and all those things to get our kids educated has been great. Everything from last week, we had Dr. Underwood in here talking about sleep, recovery. That's a big thing. Our sports science is huge. So it was an hour and a half of talking graphs on what alcohol can do to the brain and training, you know, what substance abuse can do, what lack of sleep can do, what lack of recovery can do, nutrition. So all the things that go along with recovery. He's been with the Olympics. He's been with the Navy SEALs, and he's helped those guys. The whole idea is to recover faster, push your players more, but have them recover quicker. So we've had everyone from Coach Spoelstra came last year and talked about the Miami Heat and their run and how they recover and motivation. So it's been tremendous, and you know, I think people forget sometimes, as many of these speakers that we can bring in, these young men still go out into the real world and still got to make a decision when they're 19 years old, and sometimes they make mistakes, and we got to coach them through it and help them through it.
Well, you're doing a good job coaching so far, and you know what? We have our first question, so we are going to answer James Ingram. Now, Thank you for being a coach at Tennessee. He wants to thank you first. Your energy, candidness, and passion are contagious. Now, for the question, what exactly are the responsibilities of passing game coordinator?
That's a great question. I've gotten that question quite a bit. You know, I was also the passing game coordinator at a previous school that we don't really say their name around here. but every place is a little bit different. And from Coach Jones's expectations, Coach DeBoard's expectations, I'm in charge of just making sure that I game plan the passing game. You know, our third down, our red zone, we do a lot of things as a staff. But ultimately, I'm the one really on the forefront of breaking it down, giving the suggestions, practice, I'll set up routes on air, you know, script 7-on-7, those kinds of things that are as it relates to the passing game, because most of my guys are involved in the passing game. You know, sometimes Coach DeBoard, as the offense coordinator, might want to go down to inside drill while we have one-on-ones going on. So I will make sure one-on-ones against the DBs during practice is going well, because again, I'm in charge of those guys. So we work as a staff together, but the passing game part is really game planning and taking control of the offseason projects and how to get better in the passing game.
I'm glad you brought up Coach DeBoard, new addition here. So how has he been fitting in with the staff, and what's kind of your rapport been like with
him? It's been all positive. Mm-hmm. You know, he's a great resource. He's been in the NFL. He's won a national title. He's coached at the highest level. And just to bounce ideas off him, and you know, he's been through it. Every scenario, every problem with a kid, every problem with a play, from everything, he's done it. He's been a head coach, he's been a coordinator, he's been a position coach, you know, all the way through. He's coached a multitude of positions. And not only that, I know Coach Jones said a lot, is there was a lot of great coaches that want this job to be the coordinator of Tennessee. It's a very attractive job, but not everybody might be the right fit. He was a perfect fit for us, and we're really happy to have him.
Well, Coach, I seem to be asking you a whole bunch of questions. Fans, please remember, you can send in your question by typing at the bottom of the screen. You're watching the First Tennessee First Chat. You hear me talk to Coach Z all the time. Let's send in something you want to know. And actually, just to give you a heads up into what we're doing right here, we're kind of on these like wobbly chairs. And so if you see us moving around, it's a big core workout that we're doing here. So we might be a little sore.
We're like Weeble Wobbles
tomorrow.
We're human Weeble Wobbles.
In case you're wondering why we're moving back and forth in between the screen.
A little too modern. All right, though.
Coach, okay, let's go on a little personal level then. Mm-hmm. How about, you know, being a coach, super busy. You just told me you didn't have any time for vacation time, but yet you have three kids that you tend to brag about often, and a great wife. You know, what's it like balancing the coaching life and the personal life?
Actually, me and we were just talking about this coming down, walking down to the studio. It's hard. Mm-hmm. You know, the off season, everyone thinks, well, what do you? And when I first got into coaching, my family would say, so what do you do in the off season now? And I would laugh. They're like, well, we just sit around and fold jerseys and count footballs for next year. I mean. There's like a whole nother season in the off season, but part of that is balancing, and I've tried to do a real good job. I certainly don't want my children 20 years from now go, you know what, Dad, I didn't see you around much, and you know, and I don't want to miss that time. It's really, really important to me. And I think our kids see us being good dads and good husbands, and that, you know, sometimes kids don't maybe have a great example of that at home, and we try and be that example. So, for instance, during the season, I would get up really early to get a workout in to try and stay alive and keep the heart pumping.
Because if you're going to make other kids work out, you might as well work out too, right?
And we're chasing them around the field, and we got to be active. You know, you don't want to be slow and sluggish at practice, and it keeps your energy level up. Mm-hmm. So you got to come in really early, though, because once, you know, 6:37 hits, it's a nonstop grind through till midnight could be. So you got to come in really early. This time of year, my oldest daughter is an early riser. She gets up really, really early. And so what I've done now is I'll work out at lunchtime, but have breakfast with her in the morning, which is a time that I'll never get back.
That's
and special. Everyone's sleeping, and it's a good time for me and her to connect. And how's school? What are you doing today? And you'd be amazed at just how much tighter you get just doing that. For us coaches, I know that's normal for a lot of people, but for us, it's not. So that's neat that one-on-one time with my family is huge. And last night they came up at about 5:30 and delivered Girl Scout cookies to the office.
She's a Girl Scout.
Oh yeah,
that's
and
awesome.
So the little ones running around, you know, putting the wrong cookies on everyone's desk, and you know, the whole deal. So no, I love my girls very much. They're a big part of what we do, and it's hard to balance that at this level of college football. It's hard. You have to do it. You'll go crazy if you don't, and you got to keep a good balance. And the SEC in Tennessee is unbelievable, but the most important thing is your family, and we can't lose sight of that.
Well, you guys didn't lose sight of that. I mean, I was lucky enough to get to go to Jacksonville for the Taxpayer Bowl, but it was the best part. One of the best parts, I thought, aside from the game, was watching all of you with your families. What is it like to have Coach Jones invite everyone's families along with them for the trip.
Oh, it's fantastic. Coach Jones does a really good job with the family atmosphere. And, you know, our kids will run right up to Coach. They've known him forever since Central Michigan. So to have them be able to come around the offices anytime they want, come after practice and run up to us to get, you know, the passes right after the game. And here they are running on the field right after we beat Iowa. And have them jump in your arms. Those are the things that make it worth it. And high-fiving our players, just the connection,
right,
again, is really, really unique. And Coach Jones always says, everyone says family, but do they really, really live it in their program? And we try and incorporate the both. So to have a head coach that's cognizant of our families, being a dad himself, is really neat and unique, and we try and blend it all together. So that was a great week for us to be with our families.
It was really fun to watch you guys, and you had a little bit of spare time there too, which was cool.
Mm-hmm.
Fans, I know you're sick of listening to me talk, but I know you're not sick of listening to him. So send in some questions, use the bottom of your screen, and we'll keep answering them. But until you send me a question, you have to listen to my boring old questions until we get to
maybe the last guy can ask another question.
Yeah. Ron, James, come back. And for now, why don't you, what's something someone might not know about you?
Might not know about me. We're searching now, aren't we?
I can ask you some more, but is there superstitions maybe that you have? Or?
Oh, my goodness, yes. We're very superstitious as football coaches and players.
We're
very routine-based, obviously, especially during the season. We start getting a routine going, and everything from what time you get up to what you wear to, you know, your meeting time to all those things. But something maybe that people wouldn't know about me. That's a good question.
Let's see. When the athletes are dancing around in the locker room, do you join with them?
I do.
Do you have some moves that you can pull off? That
zero
maybe...
moves. Zero. But that's why I was a very good player.
Right?
Not real loose in the hips. But you got to have fun. You got to get in there. You got to show them you're human. You just got to do that with them, and that's the best thing about team sports. Is it's those moments that you work so hard for. It's not necessarily the column that says W and L. That's the ultimate bottom line. But it's the moments like after that South Carolina game that you work so hard for. You don't see your family much for. You sleep 4 hours a night for. And you get that 20 minutes that's just special that you can't put a price on, that you can't put a tag on. So the kids are dancing. Coach Strips jumping in, all of us, you know, from the oldest guy to the youngest guy to the middle guy to GAs, and it's something that you can't forget and that you won't forget. So yeah, those are neat times for sure. Yeah.
Don't lie. Do you shed a tear once in a while when
absolutely
those moments happen? Okay. I like a guy that can, I like it.
I'm
when
a very emotional person.
That.
I wear my emotions on my sleeve. That might be my strength, but also my weakness. I understand that. So yeah, absolutely. You work really hard for it. Or sometimes, like after that South Carolina game, you're so exhausted. And it's just like you just this pour of emotion goes. I sat on the cooler, it just involuntarily just started crying. Just because, you know, there's waves of emotion.
Yeah, so definitely. Look at this. We have some questions.
Maybe it's my mom or somebody. Someone
thanks,
someone
mom.
Texting my mom to ask
appreciate
a question.
Appreciate it, guys. Mark Summers wants to know, how will the development of our O-line and having Dobbs for our announced starting quarterback help you release these future first-rounders upon the SEC this year?
Well, I think it's huge. I think anytime you have some chemistry now back there, we were still young last year, so we were just kind of working on ourselves out there. But to have, you know, when you're a young offensive line like they were, to get experience, we had to protect them a little bit. Mm-hmm. We had to maybe max protect to get some guys open. We had to do some things to help them be successful. Just like we had to with the wideouts a year before that. They were so young. We had to do some things to help them. Now this year, with a more experienced offensive line, Dobbs is able to not only know the playbook better, but also do some great things with his feet. It definitely opens up our game. And what you see with Josh defensively from other teams is they don't play as much man coverage. And for a wideout, that's a big deal, because when there's a guy back there that can't get out of trouble as well as Josh can, it puts a strain on the wideouts and the offensive line. So this year, with his ability to move the pocket, our offensive line a little more experience, it's certainly going to help our guys not always have to be so perfect. They can kind of go play a little bit. And you saw that really the second half, really Alabama on, you saw our guys start to make a ton more plays because the offensive line started coming along. We helped them schematically a little bit, and then Josh is able to get out of trouble and help us.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's good. And we've got another one. Oh,
this one's my brother.
Oh, okay. So James is your brother, apparently. But I will say he's putting you on the spot with this one. Mm-hmm. We don't usually ask these questions, but he said you asked for it. Do we beat Florida this year? How about...
Who's this, James?
James. He's really trying to stir some controversy, James. James, come on.
James, I'm going to have to give you the old coach speak on that one. You know what? The first one we're going to start with is Bowling Green, and that's just what it is.
I like that.
We're still one of the youngest teams in college mm-hmm. football. And for us to look ahead to play... Florida, it would be just silly for us right now. The power of one theme that we had a year ago really helped us, really helped our guys just focusing on one. And as coaches, we're the same way. So obviously we're going to do everything we can to beat everybody in our schedule, number one, starting with Bowling Green.
But you're going to have a whole bunch of new weapons. So let's talk about those mm-hmm. weapons. Let's talk about some of your newcomers that are coming in.
Yeah.
This has been a great class, mm-hmm. recruiting class. Talk a little bit about some of the ones that stick out to you.
Well, the guys that are here right now stick out to me a mm-hmm. lot. You know, the Juwan Jennings, Quentin yeah. Dormady at quarterback.
Take a sip of water. You yeah. have been talking a lot.
Jack Jones playing offensive line has been, you know, our offensive linemen are going to be fun to watch from Chance Hall to Jack Jones. Mm-hmm. Those guys are going to be able to come early and get going. Defensively, it's incredible. Shy Tuttle. I mean, just there's a bunch. Griff. There's just a ton that they're really going to help us in the spring defensively. Last year, we had an influx of offensive players in January. This year, we have an influx of defensive players. Mm-hmm. So, from my guys coming in the fall, you got Preston Williams, of course. And then we have some other guys that are going to be here in the summer. But from the running back spot, obviously, Alvin Kamara being here in January yeah. is a huge help to Jalen in our run game. John Kelly, just some guys that we're really, really excited about that are really going to help us. And the neat thing is you saw what the influx of freshmen a year ago did to our football team.
Right.
I mean, that energy was contagious.
Elevated
the
completely.
Talent was
yeah.
contagious. And they're like a piece of clay that hasn't been touched yet.
Yep.
So they don't have bad habits.
And you can mold them into what you want them to be.
They don't know any different. If you tell them to go do a cartwheel, that's what we
right.
do here.
Mm-hmm.
Where the older guys might have said, well, why are we doing a cartwheel? Just because they hadn't done it that way before. Right. So it's going to be neat to have the influx of new guys with these guys from last year, and that's how you build a program.
Perfect. Well, thanks for the question, James. We've got another one coming in here. How important is it to recruit for the receiving position for 2016?
Oh, my goodness.
Is that important?
This is the one that lays my head down at 11:30 yeah, every night because
sure.
I am relentlessly recruiting 2016 receivers. This is a huge, huge year for us recruiting. We'd like to take a number of wideouts, three, maybe four, and, you know, the numbers change all the time based off different issues and things in the program and guys graduating and, you know, moving positions and all stuff that you can't foresee yet. But we'd like to take a bunch. So We're old. We lose three seniors this year, and mm-hmm. Jonathan Johnson, Von Pearson, and Alton Howard. Then the following year, here we go again, we lose three more. So we're going to lose a number of really good players in the next mm-hmm. two seasons. So if you're a 2016 wideout, this is the place to come right now because you're going to play and play early. And it's exciting, you know, at the same time. It's a new challenge. And so I've been relentlessly recruiting these young men, as has our staff. Kind of like the defensive line was this year.
Right.
Getting that number
gotta
one
have
line.
Them. Yeah.
It's kind of the same thing. We needed them so mm-hmm. badly, and we did it. And Coach Tripp did a great job along with the rest of the staff. And now this year, it's kind
more
of my
pressure
turn.
On you.
We kind of need you know, that big-time wide receiver class uh-huh. for sure. So, yep.
Great. Good question. I appreciate it. Let's see. Who – Justin Walls wants to know, who would you say is the leader of this wide receiver group?
You know, that's a great question. I don't really have that one Ray Lewis type leader,
okay.
if you will, in my group. We got a lot of guys that have a lot of different skill sets themselves. A lot of guys have been through a lot of things that kind of they can use their experiences. So I really am leaning on my three seniors right now, and not any one of them need to be the Ray Lewis, I guess, if you will, of leadership. They just need to, you know, help each other. All three need to be one good leader together, play off each other. So I don't have that one stand-up guy where you can go, that's the leader. I have a bunch that do their own little part in helping this group come together.
But you had a little bit of a problem with injuries last year. Don't you think when you sit out and you watch that maybe you have a little bit more motivation and a little bit more just from watching, mm-hmm. You learn more to be a leader?
Sure, absolutely. You know, it's great when those guys have to sit out a little bit from that standpoint because they see – you know, the issues in practice. All of a sudden I'll get on a guy for maybe a certain technique or whatever, and they don't really see that when they're playing unless we watch it on film. But if they're staying there listening to me coach it, watch someone else make the mistake, it registers. It's like a real life, you know, film session right. for them. And so it does help them, absolutely. And it makes them hungry, like you said. You know, guys lose valuable time. That's one thing in college football. You have a small window, and they lose valuable time. I think Vaughn lost 5 games last year.
Right.
So those are games he's never going to get back. Right. And all these young men have dreams of going and playing in the National Football League. So, you know, time is something that they'll never get back. So, yes, it helps when they – doesn't help us, but it helps them mentally when they sit out to kind of see what they're missing.
Just a reminder to all of you, you're watching the First Chat. It's presented to you by First Tennessee, the official bank of the Vols, and we're going to continue to take your questions. Send them in the bottom of your screen. Now, they want to know how do you explain the red wristband that you wear during practice?
Yeah, this is I get this one a lot. And this isn't one that's any kind of secret. Everyone. A lot of people do this throughout college football, but we have a number of signalers on the sideline. We have a number of dummy signalers, and then we have a number of live signalers, just like everyone in the country. And you're going to find this hard to believe, but red just equals right. Not as
really?
The play, but just as a formation strength.
Usually it's stop,
just
halt,
could be, yeah.
something like
and
that.
And that's, okay. That's about it. And, you know, it can mean different things, different games, but for the most part it just means – right.
All right.
For formation, not for play. So
correct. I understand.
Easy. Yep.
All right. Let's see here. What can we expect from Josh Malone as a sophomore? Were you pleased with his freshman season?
Yeah. You know what? Let me say this about Josh. I actually just left the weight room and he was in there doing the speed bag, working on his hand violence and his hand quickness. Okay. And Josh has earned my respect for many reasons. Number one, He had a great first 5 games, I guess, up until Ole Miss, I don't know how many, and then he kind of hit a wall, freshman wall, and a lot of that was due to his body, rest and recovery. Mm-hmm. And when you're a freshman, that's hard. It's hard to realize what the grind of an SEC season is like, and he kind of ran into that wall and really couldn't. He had a couple injuries here and there that he could never really get right from, and then it affected his season. But the reason he's got my respect is he never said a word about it. All he did was get wrapped up, taped up, iced up, and kept going. And he knew he wasn't himself. And it's hard when you're a skilled player to go out there and not maybe be as quick as you were, fast as you were. It's hard to be uncomfortable and play. And so he learned a ton this season about what it takes to take care of your body. We play different around here. We have a different style. We play 63 all the time. We're straining to get bodies on bodies. We're not those teams where just they take one step and watch the ball go if they don't get it. So we tax the body here, and we do. And that's why you recruit a lot of wideouts. And as a freshman, that's hard to really realize, you know, that you really have to take care of yourself. But he's going to have a tremendous career here. He's working his tail off right now. The sky is the limit for Josh. He's everything you're looking for, physical standpoint. And he loves football. You're not going to have to worry about him off the field. Great family. Mm-hmm. So I expect huge things from Josh.
My favorite story that I've ever heard about between you and Josh was this season when he hadn't scored a touchdown in a while. And, you know, you go from high school, you're scoring all the time. You're the main man on the team. But then you guys had a moment before the game of his first touchdown. Why don't you tell, in case people didn't see it, I know the story, but why don't you tell them?
Well, this is real. I think we were at pregame meal, and it was quiet. And it was right before we were, you know, go watch highlight film, get on the buses. And Josh was sitting next to me, and we let him wear headphones for pregame meals. The only meal they're allowed to just kind of just go get ready. Mm-hmm. However you get yourself ready for the game. So it's really quiet in the team room, and he's eating, and he takes the head. I sit right next to him. Just constant coaching. He takes his headphone out. And he goes, "Hey, coach." Looked over at me. I said, "Yeah." He goes, "You know, I haven't scored a touchdown here yet," and I didn't even register. Like I don't count touchdowns. We're just going to try to win games. And I said, "Really?" He goes, "Yeah." I'm like, "Wow, well maybe this is the night." So he scores his first touchdown against Alabama and then goes crazy, and we got a great picture of it. So he came over and he looks at me, I look at him, it was kind of like,
"Well, I called it."
Yeah, let's talk about having more next week and maybe it'll happen. So yeah, it was a good moment for him to score in Neyland Stadium, his home state, right in front of his family.
Yeah.
They were right there in the crowd and just couldn't have been happier for him at the moment.
Love it. Love the story. Love it. Let's see. Do you have any good recruiting stories from this year's class? You had a good one with Vaughn last year.
Yeah.
Vaughn's was a good one.
Yeah.
Good question.
Yeah. No, not really from this year. It was pretty uneventful this year. Coach Jones probably has the best ones from just barely making it certain places, right, and things like that. But no, mine was pretty uneventful. I mean, this year there was no, I don't know how you beat driving through the mountains eating like 15-year-old stew. I don't know how you beat that. So that one was pretty crazy. But no, I don't have any crazy ones from this year. I mean,
I don't know how you cannot have a crazy one, but yet do a Beyonce cover.
Yeah.
So, I mean, cool. I know everybody kind of touches on the recruits, but that was pretty wild.
That was cool. That was cool.
All right, let's continue on here. All right. Coach, are we going to throw down the field more this year? I know injuries hurt us last year, but I'd like to see us take advantage of all the weapons we have.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we're diving in hard right now into our down the field pass game and our play action game and those things. You know, we took some shots down the field last year, that weren't successful for whatever reason, weren't as good as we'd like to be back there for a number of reasons, from protection to maybe a bad route to maybe an underthrown football. So there's a lot of things that go into, not completing a deep ball. We're definitely going to do that. We actually spent the last 2 days at the Dolphins and out with one of my projects on just different ways that they do things, throwing the ball down the field. And so, yeah, that's one thing we definitely as a staff looked at and said we need to do better. That's higher on our priority list. So, absolutely.
Awesome. Thanks, Kyle, for the question. Mm-hmm. Let's see down here. Jerry Goodman. He wants to know, Coach Zach was with Butch when DeBoard was at Central Michigan. If so, what position did you coach, and what was your relationship with Coach DeBoard?
Yeah. No, I wasn't on Coach DeBoard's staff. Mm-hmm. I was actually at another school in the MAC. I was at Bowling Green. So I was playing against Coach Jones and Coach DeBoard as the receiver coach at Bowling Green at the time. Never lost to him, by the way. Just for that.
Notice,
little dig right there. We were undefeated against both of them.
The smack talk never ends.
Never ends. We're competitors. That's what we do. So. Actually, me and Coach DeBoer, we were watching cutups this morning, and there was a play that we run here that we ran a bunch at Bowling Green. I said, by the way, Coach, we wore you out with this play. And he laughed. And
you remember? Just, yeah. I'm sure
he did, actually. He did, actually. He's a football junkie, so he remembers those things. So, but I was with Coach Jones in 1998, Coach Jones's first. That was my senior year. Mm-hmm. So I was on – he was on staff when I was a player at Central Michigan, his first job. Coach Martinez was the DB coach. Coach Mahoney was the O-line coach. So, yeah, we all go back pretty far.
So do you just kind of elbow them and make sure they know you're the younger one out of all of them?
Yeah, it's not too much anymore. It's getting old now.
All right, let's hop in. This is a good question. Mm-hmm. What aspects of Dave Lawson's strength program are most important for just specifically the wide receivers?
Yeah, Coach Lawson does a great job of one thing about the way that we play, our tempo and our style, it has to be an entire program thing. It can't be just we go play fast at practice, and then they lift really slow and do Olympic lifts in the weight room. Coach Lawson is great at adapting, so his whole program is based around our style of play. Mm-hmm. So his strength program is based off our guys being able to have endurance and go fast, the different things that we do tempo standpoint. So you got to train like that. That's how they train. So. How they train and go fast and circuits is how we practice and how we play. So that's the most important part. And the other thing from our standpoint is just the rest and recovery that Coach Lawson does with our guys from the hurdles to getting their legs rubbed out to different stretch things. Those are the things that people don't see that are as important as a bench press or squat for my players.
All right. And the last question that we're going to take for the day, coming in right here, how much — we've talked a little bit about Vaughn right now, but how much impact does Vaughn have on the younger players since he's so much older than everyone?
Yeah, he's like 42 years old.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We tease him all the time. All the time. He's 42 going on 12, I think. But he has some impact because he's been through a lot, you know. It's funny because last night I said, hey, are you good with career night tomorrow? Mm-hmm. You got your coat and tie and you're ready to roll. You know, make sure you're clean shaven, the whole deal. And, you know, this is a big deal. He's like, yeah, absolutely, Coach. He's like, I'm not going back to some of my old jobs. So that impact he has, he's been through it before. Mm-hmm. He's appreciative of being here. So that's the impact that he has on those guys. And you know what? The other impact he has, doesn't matter if he's a senior, he's got a ton of energy, a ton of juice. He's fun to coach, and the other players feed off him.
Awesome. Well, Coach. Mm-hmm. Coach, I really appreciate you sitting down. This was our first, Google Hangout. Thanks for being our guinea pig.
We're the guinea pigs. That's
maybe
fine.
Maybe we'll have more city chairs.
We had a slow start, but we
did. Thanks, guys,
also,
for picking up.
Also, the next coach is going to get like 1,000 questions in a minute.
Maybe they just didn't like you.
It's all right.
Just kidding. Thank you for watching and tuning in to First Tennessee First Chat, and I'm excited for the next time we do this. Thanks for joining me. And
Thank
I was just
you.
Kidding. Everybody loves Coach C. How could you not?
Mm-hmm. With my core still.